This video was made possible by Skillshare, home to over 28,000 classes that'll teach you just about anything. In 1969, Britain set out to build a train unlike any other, a high-speed train that would need to run on high-speed railway. When everyone else was pouring billions into constructing new, smooth, and straight high-speed rail lines, the British would instead design a train that could reach incredible speeds on any kind of track, even twisting and winding railways built 100 years earlier. Because this train would lean into corners like a motorcycle, and it promised to bring Britain's antiquated railways into the 20th century.
Smooth, it's quiet, and an altogether delightful experience. Everything that the developers and designers have told me the train should do, it does appear to do, and does it exceptionally well.
This was going to be the advanced passenger train, and in an era of automobiles and jet travel, it was going to save Britain's railways. In the 1960s, Britain's railways were in trouble. After declining for decades, there were fewer people riding trains in 1965 than there were back in 1890, and rail lines around the country were shutting down. The problem was, Britain's railways were slow and antiquated. Steam locomotives were still in use well into the 1960s, and that stood in contrast against the exciting freedom of automobiles and the speed and glamour of jet-powered air travel. If British Rail was going to compete in this new era, they'd need much faster trains. Because elsewhere in the world, high-speed rail was proving that it could win back passengers. Japan's new bullet trains were an instant success, carrying over 100 million passengers in just the first 3 years of service. But high-speed trains need special tracks, long straight sections of rail, and gentle curves. And to get their bullet trains to work, the Japanese built an entirely new high-speed rail line, constructing thousands of bridges and tunneling right through mountains. Further TGV, the French would end up doing much of the same, building hundreds of kilometers of high-speed track. But in Britain, there wasn't going to be any new railway. For one, the country already had a vast rail network, and with ridership declining, much of it was underutilized. So the British set out to engineer a new kind of high-speed train, one that would run on Britain's existing railways. But it wasn't going to be easy. Britain's 100-year-old rail network was full of twists and turns, and a train can only round a bend so fast before the ride becomes too uncomfortable, because lateral forces can send items flying off tables, or even knock passengers off their feet. The Japanese and French built their new high-speed rail lines with gentle banked curves to minimize these lateral forces. The British would instead come up with a brilliant alternative. Instead of building tilted tracks, they'd engineer a tilting train. By leaning the rail cars into curves, like a motorcycle, lateral forces on passengers could be minimized or even eliminated altogether. And British Rail would pioneer the world's first active tilting system. Unlike earlier tilting suspensions, it would use computers and sensors to read forces and hydraulic rams to actively tilt each rail car. It took British Rail nearly two decades to develop the technologies. But by 1979, they had built a train unlike any in British history. It would be called the Advanced Passenger Train. Driven by eight traction motors housed in central power cars, the APT produced a total of 8,000 horsepower, making it the most powerful domestic train to ever operate in Britain. With its advanced braking system, the APT could quickly decelerate from high speeds, allowing it to work within Britain's outdated signaling system. And with active tilting, it could round a bend nearly twice as fast as any British train, And during testing in 1979, the APT hit 261 kilometers an hour, setting a new British speed record, one that would hold for another 23 years. Britain's new train was going to revolutionize its railways, and there were plans to build a fleet of over 50. But when the APT entered service as a prototype on December 7, 1981, almost overnight it went from being heralded as the train of the future to the subject of intense media ridicule. The train was plagued by technical problems, everything from frozen brakes to failed tilting mechanisms. And on the third day of service, one even broke down on the way from Glasgow to London. But most embarrassing, the tilt caused nearly a third of passengers to become motion sick. So bad were the problems that after just a couple weeks, British Rail was forced to pull the APT from service. It would take another 3 years of development and testing just to sort out all the issues. In the meantime, British Rail tried to fight back against the negative press, like in this promotional video featuring rattling dishes and a cup of coffee on the verge of spilling.
The conventional service from Glasgow to Euston is good. It's not a patch on this. It's smooth, it's quiet, and an altogether delightful experience. Everything that the developers and designers have told me the train should do, it does appear to do, and does it exceptionally well.
But the press had already written the APT's obituary. The train had been put into service before it was ready. Over 15 years and £50 million had gone into development. But designing a 250 km an hour train to run on an antiquated rail network proved too ambitious for British Rail. The APT was supposed to enter service as early as 1976, but with so many novel features needing development all at once, the program was difficult to manage. And it was plagued by technical hurdles, delays, and in some cases, complete redesigns. And the APT wasn't adequately tested, moving from the experimental stage to a fully functional prototype after having run just 37,000 kilometers. Meanwhile, in testing their TGV, the French racked up nearly 500,000 kilometers. And even as the experimental APT was beginning to prove itself, many within British Rail were hostile towards the program, preferring conventional rail technologies over such a revolutionary leap. So British Rail split its resources and began developing a more conventional and not quite as fast diesel train without active tilting. Throw in labor disputes, quality control issues, and wavering political support, and the entire program might have been doomed from the start. By 1980, Britain was in an economic recession. And with the APT program at risk of being cancelled altogether, the prototype trains were rushed into service. When it was reintroduced again 3 years later in 1984, the active tilt had been modified to reduce motion sickness, and the trains proved reliable in service. But none of that mattered, because the APT could never operate to its full potential, having to share tracks with slower trains and overhead electrical lines that weren't designed for higher speeds. The APT was held back by the very same outdated rail network that it was supposed to overcome. With little will to develop it any further, the APT was quietly removed from service in 1986. But there's a final twist of irony in the APT story. Because in 1982, British Rail sold patents for its tilting technology to Italy's Fiat, who were developing an active tilting train of their own. In 2002, Italian-designed tilting trains were reintroduced to Britain's railways. Today, they operate along the London to Glasgow route, which is the exact same route the APT was once supposed to serve. Starting this YouTube channel has been one of the most rewarding things I've ever done. Not a day goes by where I don't look forward to working on the next Mustard video, because I can't think of anything more rewarding than doing something creative and sharing it with the world. If you've been thinking about starting your own YouTube channel, do it, because demand for high-quality YouTube content is growing every day. But a lot goes into making videos that people actually want to watch. So I'd start by learning directly from YouTube's top creators. And Skillshare offers fantastic classes that'll teach you everything you need to know. From how to pick the right topics, to research, storytelling, audio, and animation. With over 28,000 Skillshare classes on offer, covering just about anything you can think of, you can jump right in and learn whatever it is you want to learn. And the best part, a premium subscription to Skillshare is less than $10 a month. But if you're one of the first 500 people to sign up using the link in the description below, you get 2 months for absolutely free.